I voted against the reform bill in the House because what they did was they basically said instead of counting on 8.5% returns, now they're going to count on 7.5% returns. That was their reform. Are you kidding me? Where are you finding 7.5%? What? Spain's bonds? I don't know. They're going down. Greek bonds? What are you buying? You know, so there's no solvency there. So if you stand with people like Senator Jim DeMint, Senator Tom Coburn,
send him a check.
Senator Vitter. From the House. They do exist. And there are people who are willing to stand up. And why this seat is in, what's that? Oh, do you really think the media elites in Washington want to blast it up? Yeah, you got to go on their websites. You have to seek them out. That's why the internet, and that's why we can't have internet censorship. So listen to your kids when it comes to SOPA and HIPAA. All right, that's all I'm going to say. If you're older than me, listen to your kids when it comes to internet freedom. It has to be maintained because that is our way of getting accurate news. All right, because the media will take and twist anything. They'll feed you the news that they want you to be fed. And what's disappointing is you have very few real true newspaper men and women left because, simply put, they either want to go up through the ranks of MSNBC, New York Times, or they want to get into Fox News Drudge Report so they don't just report the news to you. Do you see what I'm saying? So that's very important, but the Eric Holder, the oversight, that's a job that's been lost in Congress. Where's the oversight? That's why people love ISA, right? Yeah. If you like ISA, why do you like him? Because he's running oversight over what the government has done, the policies that the government has. But that's tough to win an election on. Hey, I'm going to have good oversight instead of, hey, I'm going to cook you a hot dish. You know, I mean, so, but that's what we have to get back to in this country, yes.
Okay, first question here, or second question here. As a senator, what are your ideas for improving education by increasing competition, voucher system, et cetera? What are your ideas?
Well, I think getting the Federal Department of Education out of the way would be the first step, and then returning that responsibility as locally as possible. So what I did in the state house is I had a bill that went right down Republican, Democrat, Republican, Democrat, Republican, Democrat. All the teachers signed on, and it was a Board of Ed bill. And what it did was it allowed you as a school district to take your school district by vote of the people or by vote of the school board and turn it into a Board of Education. At that point, the Board of Education is just an accountability board. They want those schools to perform at a certain level, whether it's by test or whether it's by how many graduate or whatever it is, but you set goals for your schools. Do you see what I'm saying? Then you don't get the secondary director of curriculum and formative assessment for red-haired kids, East Highway 3. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because you have to do this. What it does is it puts them on a diet. My bill would have taken 95% of all state funding by categorical for K-12 spending and put it to the principal. Get it as close to the kid as possible. Because if you don't, when it filters down through the system, the bureaucrats will all just grab a hold of it. Because they'll have their program that they want to run, their great idea, oh, I'm going to fix this, I'm going to fix that. But simply put, do they ever fix it? No, look at the achievement gap that's in Minneapolis and St. Paul. 14, 15,000 a kid we put into St. Paul, Minneapolis. For years, years, decades. What's been the return? No, 50% graduation rate? Is that what we wanted? No, all the money in the world won't fix that. So what you need is to get the Federal Department of Education out of the way in terms of special ed specifically, because you have so much paperwork that these people have to put up with who are trying to work with our kids, that they have 1 or 2 hours a day that are just for paperwork plus their prep out. Well, now you're taking the teacher out of the classroom to do paperwork. I just talked to a teacher on Sunday afternoon about this at a fundraiser. And she's a complete independent. She's not a Republican or Democrat. She is a complete, bona fide independent. But I won her over. Because what she wanted to hear was get the government out of the way. Isn't that interesting? Even the teachers are starting to say get the government out of the way. It doesn't matter if it's my wife's daycare, teachers, education, but you talk about energy, talk about manufacturing. You talk about any part of the government, any part of the, any sector in our in our economy, and the words you're hearing from people are get the government out of the way. So the same thing has to be put forward with educational policy. And yeah, we voted for vouchers. We voted to put, there's got to be choice for parents.
I have a follow-up question on education. You look at funding on education and where the money is pooled to the kids, mm-hmm. where we have the kids who have the most problems with learning and emotional problems getting most of the funding, and the kids who are more excelling getting the least amount of funding. Can you address that along with mandates mm-hmm. on a local level, the over 100 mandates from the state on top of the federal mandates?
Yeah, that never come with the funding right. to get it done. Exactly. So then most of your money gets channeled into helping the kids who have the most either learning disabilities, physical disabilities, mental disabilities.
Right.
It doesn't matter. So what we need to start doing is, and again, this is a state issue, so I'm running to be a U.S. senator. So my goal is to keep my hands off of it. If they want to spend money, I want to be there to say, get the money as close to the classroom and the kid as possible, because then you can actually start the process of equalizing this funding. And maybe that's something that the federal government does have a role in, maybe it doesn't, and you can sure debate it. I mean, I'm sorry, but that platform to revitalize America, it whacks the federal Department of Education. And I think we do have to talk about zero-based budgeting the Department of Education and then prioritize it. But you, that's more of a question for your state. When I was on K-12 finance, and I'm a child's a child guy. A child's a child. And I know that they're, we need categoricals and, you know, to equalize this and equalize that. And how? Aren't you then picking and choosing? Isn't that discrimination? Isn't everybody supposed to be equal in this country? So shouldn't you be giving the resources out to the schools and then letting the principals and the teachers figure out how they're going to deal with it? I don't. If you want to start tinkering with it, just remember that when we tinker with it, you know, when the Republicans get in charge and tinker with it, then what's going to happen? Then all of a sudden you get Larry Pogamiller, who gets in charge in the Senate, right, for how many years? 857 years. And he gets in charge, and what does he do? He makes it so that you pull this lever, the money drops down here. Pull that lever, the money drops down there. And now you got so many categoricals that nobody understands where it's going. And very few people, parents included, understand how their kids' education is being funded. So make it easier. Make it easier. And equalize the funding per kid.
Okay, second question, or third question, lose track. On your website, you mentioned quite a bit about the size. You mentioned tonight the size of an increase in the size of the federal government, mm-hmm. and you say that you'll work to cut the size of the federal government, and then you said you also will you'll focus on creating jobs in Minnesota. Specifically, how will you do that? How will you operate?
By getting the government out of the way. The government doesn't create jobs. So if you shrink the government,
what ideas specifically?
One Canada, one child, or Canada, one project, one review. That's one big idea. Canada has a situation right now with their environmental review process that is so much more efficient than ours. It makes us look terrible. You call up to PolyMet, and our staff did. 7 years they've been trying to get PolyMet open. That's the second or third largest precious metals find in the world. 7 years. What's that?
Yeah,
and 7 years trying to get it open. And you call up there and you ask them, well, how long is it going to take? Well, about 10 years. Are you upset by that?
Yes.
No, you ask them. That's what I thought. I thought they'd be upset. Aren't you upset by that? No, it's industry standards. That's typically what happens. It takes about a decade to get some of these places open. Because the permitting process is local, state, federal, county, all different levels of government have their own permitting. What Canada does, one project, one review, this is a role of federal government because property rights are very difficult to define in the air and in the water.